Hello, everybody. Welcome to Confessions of an Anti-Therapist. I'm your host, Joe LaChance, and I am joined here, of course, today by the one and only anti-therapist himself, Andy Schoenfeld. Andy, how are you today?
Very good.
Very good. Great, Andy. So today, I wanted to kind of dive into diagnosis and what is diagnosis and why therapists depend so much on this diagnosis. What is it? It comes from the Greek word gnosis, to know.
Well, you're always coming to some kind of conclusion within yourself. You feel a pain in your stomach, so you conclude that you're hungry. You feel really tired, so you conclude that you need to get some sleep. You're always coming to a conclusion. After many days of being sad, you might come to the conclusion that you're melancholy or you're depressed. If you're worrying constantly and you've got the jitters all the time, you're going to come to the conclusion that you're anxious. So society has basically taught us what's, when it comes to our psychological world, what certain feelings mean and the labels attached to it.
Right. So now, if somebody determines they're feeling depressed and they decide to go to a therapist, okay, the therapist will give them, listen to what they have to say, and then give them a diagnosis based on what they had to say. So now, what are they diagnosing, actually?
Well, client sits down, talks about how feeling so horrible about their life. Eventually, the therapist takes that information, comes up with a diagnosis of, you know, being depressed. But none of that information is consciously driven. So what the therapist is doing is taking subconscious content and elevating it to a conscious level. And so as far as I'm concerned, any diagnosis that uses what people say as a way to come to a conclusion about what they're going through is completely faulty.
They're diagnosing their vomit, basically.
I'll give you a better...
They're therapizing their vomit.
I'll give you a better idea. Out of certain emotions, let's take depression. And we could relate depression to certain types of emotional experiences. Some people experience depression as sad. Some people experience depression as sad and angry. Some people experience depression as sad, angry, and frustrated. Let's just use those as an example.
Okay.
So if you're going to take someone's mind vomit and use that to form a conclusion based on who they are, I'll offer another idea, another way of looking at it. If the person is experiencing a lot of sadness, then they have things that they have to ask, what am I having difficulty accepting? Sadness means, the definition of sadness is difficulty accepting a condition or situation. And so we don't diagnose the person as having difficulty accepting a condition or situation. We go after the tag, sad or depressed. That doesn't make sense as far as I'm concerned. If you have someone that's angry, the definition of anger is wanting more of yourself. If you're just going to say that person is depressed and they have angry symptoms, that really doesn't help anyone.
Right. Now, we all go through moments of depression. We all go through moments of anger. But what these people seem to have is chronic battles with depression and chronic problems with anger. They constantly come up. And it's probably because they're constantly listening to the same vomit.
Yeah.
And then what happens is the psychotherapist or whoever it is ends up speaking to that vomit instead of actually speaking to the person and what they really want, what they're looking for. They're speaking more to the vomit.
Yeah.
And they're therapizing the vomit.
Yeah, that can go on for 50, 60, 70, 80, 100 weeks.
Because the therapist never, maybe the therapist doesn't even understand, never tells the person that this is a constant vomit program that is running in your head and never tries to teach them how to overcome that program. They just work within the program.
Well, if you pay attention, life is always speaking to us. Life speaks to you when you're thirsty, you need water. When you're hungry, you need nutrition. When you're tired, you need sleep. Life is talking to you. When you have a pain in your bowel, you need to go to the bathroom. Why is it that when life speaks to us in those areas, it's okay, but when life speaks to us through emotions, all of a sudden it's an indicator that there's something wrong with us? Could you imagine? Yo, man, what's up today? Oh, there's something really wrong with me. Well, what's the matter? Oh, man, I gotta go to the bathroom. That's not a problem. That's a fact of life. But when it comes to emotional reactions, and life speaks to us, life tells us that we need to put more skin in the game. We need to step up and do more. Life tells us that we need to learn to accept situations and conditions that might be difficult. Life tells us that we need to be able to choose wisely. That's the message of frustration. Frustration says that the voice of logic and reason is telling you that there's a better choice that you can make, but you're not choosing it.
Right.
And so instead of pathologicalizing these things, we can basically change the way the game is run. Emotions, things that we spend billions of dollars a year on medications to make them go away, emotions could, I'm not saying it's a 100% thing, it's my suggestion, emotions could be indicators that there's something inside of us called life trying to speak to us, to raise right. us to a higher condition. It's nuts to be pathologicalizing these things. It doesn't make sense, and it makes people feel worse when you give them the idea that they're self-sabotaging, they're doing it to themselves, they're their own worst enemy. That's a joke, man. That is just perfectly incorrect.
Making them think that there's something wrong with them. And here's what I find, that people end up owning these diagnoses, and it becomes a part of their identity, and they carry it around with them.
That's called your self-identification. Your self-identification is the moment-by-moment conceptualization that comes up in your head regarding yourself. I feel helpless. I feel not good enough. The converse would be, I feel very self-assured. I feel that I'm on the right track. Your self-identification is not consciously driven. It comes up in reaction to situations. If your self-identification puts you down or places you above others, you're biologically designed to feel an emotional disruption. So all of these emotional disruptions that life is giving us are brought to us to help us move in the correct direction. What we've done is we've taken the indicators that life has given us and we've turned it into indicator of pathology.
Right.
That's not a good idea. You wonder why the state of the world is in the state the way it is right now. Anytime you mindlessly accept a limiting belief, you're biologically programmed to feel an emotional disruption. You can't get away from it. No amount of incorrect diagnosis is going to make it better. You're just going to inoculate the society with the idea that they're sick.
And this is what has happened. Right, because the majority of society is mindlessly accepting limiting beliefs right now that are keeping them in a state of either mental illness or physical illness or in a state of confusion, more or less. And we see this happening more and more these days. And I think a lot of it comes from people focusing more on the emotion itself and almost living in the emotion rather than realizing what the emotion is trying to tell
them. We've become narcissistically preoccupied with our emotional reactions and the idea that other people's and their insensitivities are leading me to feel the way I feel. That is 100% incorrect. Nobody makes you feel the way you feel. Your feelings are a product of your subconscious process. It's a product of the vomit that you've inherited. We all have the same vomit. We have different tendencies on how we perceive that vomit. You have an entire society that is so preoccupied in having to say the right things to the right people so we don't offend them. And it gets to the point where people are so lost in the processes of regarding their mental health that I had someone the other day say to me, well, how do I deal with being depressed? Like then another person said, how do I deal with being anxious? It's very important to realize that our eyes look upon the world and we see the world through our subconscious. The limiting beliefs that we have, those are the things that cause the discrepant emotions that we feel. The more preoccupied you are looking out upon the world, the less time you're going to be spending in an inner intuitive world where you can begin to see the world the way you want to see the world. I work with a lot of young people. They don't know what they're going to do after college, and they complain about the tasks, the jobs that they have now, that they're menial, that they're not good enough. And then they start to spew vomit that they're never going to get anywhere. I said to one kid earlier this morning, you're not going to create a victory 5 years from now unless you start to create a victory today. You're not going to create a victory 10 years from now unless you learn to create a victory today. So I said to him, take a portion of your day, let's say from 9 o'clock to 12 o'clock, see it in your mind, see it how you want it to happen, as if it's a fast-moving movie. As you do that, look for sound, add sound. As you do that, look for the type of emotion that you want to see visualized, the emotion that you're going to see through the visual action. Spend more time in your inner imaging system than you spend time out preoccupied by your physical emotions. The more you do that, the more you start to live in a different place. And it takes practice, and you have to cultivate it. If you saved a dime each day over a 10-year period of time, you'll have quite a size of, you'll have a good
amount of money.
Won't be rich, but you'll have about $2,000. If every day you take the day and break it up into 3-hour sections, see it move as a fast-moving movie, look for the physical action. In that physical action, see the physical action demonstrate the type of emotion you want to experience. Stay with it. When I started to do it, I would stare at something and not move my eye. And I'd go into that inner place. The more you do that, the more you cultivate the ability to walk around your inner intuitive world. This is making a cause that over time is going to lead to an effect. What I observe in the young people, and even the middle-aged people I work with, they're so preoccupied with feeling bad that they can't focus on anything other than wanting to feel better. And so they moan and complain about their job. They don't do the best that they can in the day. I said to one kid, said, I've been a therapist, a social worker for 38 years. I said, at least half of that time, I didn't want to be a social worker.
Oh, you think
like you'd want to do this day in and day out and day in? No. But there was something inside of me that said, I have to do the best job possible, and that's how I innovated. That's how I learned all that stuff about the subconscious. I didn't read that stuff in a book. I experienced all of that stuff in a living, real session with a client. I stuck with it. And so you're not going to take this information and all of a sudden push a button and have some rapid, transformative experience. This is hard work. This is something that you have to be dedicated to. This is something that you have to do on a daily basis. And you have to realize that if you're preoccupied with your emotional reactions, you're preoccupied with what your vomit eyes are seeing in the physical world. You're not going into an inner intuitive world. It's a different experience. Now, to enter the inner intuitive world, as an example, you could stare at a dot and don't move your eyeball. After about 30 seconds, you'll start to see things get a little fuzzy. Start to practice seeing images with your eyes open. That means you start to practice seeing images with your inner eye. So you're staring directly at something with your physical eye, but you start to open up the inner realm. And that's your imaging system. See things move at a very, very fast speed. See the physical action demonstrate the emotion that you want to feel. So it's like a lot of time, if I'm in a session and I'll say I don't feel well or I don't want to do it, I'll see the session move by really, really quick with me jumping up and down.
Right.
And then I'll tap in the emotion that I want. And I'll do that a lot. Because who wants to be sitting and talking to people all day long? That's not realistic. Instead, what's more realistic is learning how to overcome that resistance, learning how to overcome that tendency to whine and complain. Because me, like anyone else, we whine and complain about things. But that has not defined my past 40 years of experience. While it was there, I spent a lot of time going inside to create value. That's our basic tendency or our basic nature. So psychotherapy, as far as I'm concerned, is making a mistake. It puts too much emphasis on emotions. It puts too much emphasis on getting rid of quote-unquote unwanted emotions. That's like saying we need to get rid of crapping.
Right, because emotions are going to happen no matter what. You're gonna have them every day no matter how much you try not to.
Anytime you mindlessly accept a limiting belief. Now, why is that? What does mindlessly mean? We've said this before. Your moment-to-moment experience is a hypnotic reality. It's hypnosis. You're involved in that hypnosis. As such, what you hear in your head, you believe is your thinking. You're not. You're listening. You also have emotional feelings. Those two things combine, what you hear, you're hearing something, and you're feeling something, lead you to believe that it's real. It's right. A hypnotic reality.
Right.
Psychotherapy has spent so much time trying to help us get rid of this hypnotic reality that they've pathologicalized it without realizing it's life trying to speak to us to get us on the right track. Also, psychotherapy has made us too, quote unquote, sensitive to everyone's feelings. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm not saying that we should sit around and outright rank on people and make fun of people. But one has to understand that if someone says something and you get emotionally bothered, it's because you're accepting some type of limitation. Either accepting what they're saying, that you're no good or you're not good enough, or accepting the idea that that other person who's talking is a loser. If you place yourself above other people or put yourself down, you're biologically defined and feel an emotional disruption.
Right. So what I'm hearing you saying is what you're doing in your head is really creating the outcomes like 3 hours at a time, like creating your day in your head as it goes rather than reacting, which is what most people do is react to our outer circumstance. Like you said, react to what you see, react to what somebody says to you, react to something you see on TV instead of actually creating what you want to see.
Also, the other thing that winds up happening to me is when I do that sort of thing, I get a feeling inside of me, I don't know, you call it compassion or want to, it's almost like my own vomit kind of goes away. And what winds up showing itself is this desire to create value, like a desire to do something in a forward movement, put something on the table for people to experience. The more I wind up experiencing that when I sit with other people, they wind up having experiences that are really kind of hard to believe. You know, they're kind of hard to explain. It's not magic. There's nothing magic, and there's God, nothing special about me. I just spent more time doing it. It's consistent effort going inside and seeing things the way you want to see it, as opposed to using your physical eyes to see what you don't like. The physical eyes, what causes your emotion. When you go inside into the inner world, you see things move. You use physical movement as a way of expressing emotional sensation.
Right.
So if you want to experience a situation with someone where, let's say, you're kind of giddy, you make that visualization very broad. People jumping up and down, balloons flying all over the place. Might sound nuts, but for me, the more broad the visualization, the bigger it is, the more the emotional impact is. And I use that consistently on a daily basis, let's say 2-3 hour slots. A lot of times it'll be if I start thinking about if I start hearing shit in my head about the future, I'll be like, no, I don't want to hear blah, blah, blah about the future. I want to see the future. So like, let's say a worry vomit comes in my head. I'll catch the vomit and I'll, instead of quote unquote
worrying, right,
blah, blah, blahing about it, which people call thinking, but it's listening. Instead of listening to that vomit, I'll see that future circumstance unfold in my mind. The emotion comes through the physical activity. If I want to feel, let's say, calm and easy, this is me now. See, my mind just did that. I saw myself floating nicely underwater. If I wanted to see myself as expansive, I would see myself flying in the sky. There are no rules when it comes to that.
To the imagination.
To that world. Your imaging system, you can experience a broad variety of things, and your biological body will fall in line with what you're seeing.
Now, what do you say? I'm sure you've had clients like this. What do you say to somebody who's like, I'm afraid to go inside? You know those people who constantly have to stay busy because they don't want to stop and think. What do you say to a client, I'm afraid to go inside, or I can't go inside, or I can't visualize?
Oh, myself personally?
What do you say to them? Yeah, you're the therapist.
The thing that I've said to people is, well, that's a shame. I'm sorry.
And then how do they react?
Get pissed.
Have you been able to help people overcome those blocks?
Well,
because many people have them.
In my experience, one of the best tools that I have is getting angry. It's not getting angry at people. It's getting angry. It's kind of like the emotion of fire. So if I have someone that's stuck like that, I'll literally light a fire inside of myself. I won't say anything, but it will cause me to, because now I'm not going after them visualizing. If they're not up to the point of they're not there, then I don't go there. I wind up lighting a fire inside of myself, and I wind up going after their vomit very, very strong to get them to see that they're not thinking. Now, these are people, the knot of personal reality is so strongly fixed that right. They can't in any way, shape, or form separate themselves.
Detach
from
themselves
it.
From material, right.
So I have spent, in some circumstances, with one individual, I spent about 15 years hammering it.
So it can take time because people have vomit that actually prevents them from going inside, from overcoming the vomit.
That was about a 15-year process. Eventually it happened, and eventually that individual got there. But like I said, the way I protect myself in those circumstances is I don't want to go to frustration. Frustration is knowing better but not choosing. Anger is wanting to put more of yourself in the game. So I would wind up getting angry. Not at her. I would wind up getting angry, like light that energy up to get my motor going so I can withstand my own vomituous reaction to her crap.
Right.
Or his crap.
Or whoever it may be. Right, because I'm sure as a therapist, you do run into resistance because a lot of people are used to that typical, oh, what was your relationship with your father like? And da-da-da-da-da, and digging
in. Oh, yeah,
in
you,
and
get
all.
You get a lot of that, but I could really give a hoots about what happened to someone yesterday. I'm more interested in helping them see how you can create a better moment for right now today. Most people that are adult, they go to work, they have bills to pay, they have a house or an apartment to take care of, they have a relationship, or they might have a kid, they might have a car. They have daily life that you have to take care of. You're not going to have a victory in 10 years from now unless you have a massive victory today. The way to have that victory is to start seeing things on the inside world. Be less preoccupied with how you feel. The saying is, it doesn't matter how you feel. It matters how you want to feel. Anyone that's preoccupied by how they feel, they've been taught by society a lie. So you basically don't get anywhere. So you basically feel like a sheeple. So you basically feel helpless. So you could sit and watch the news at night and complain how messed up society is.
Yeah.
So you can basically spin around in circles.
On the merry-go-round.
That's all that does. It doesn't really help you get anywhere.
Right. So really what you're saying by doing all that, you're really only feeding your vomit.
Yeah, that's all you're doing. That's all you're doing. Watch, we'll do this here. I'm the client, you're the therapist.
Okay.
Right? Be just traditional therapist.
Okay.
So ask me, why am I here today?
So Andy, why are you here today? What's going on?
I've lost any hope that I have for life. I'm hopeless. Nothing seems to go right. Everything that I have, I wind up losing. And I don't know. It's either I got a curse on my back, or God hates me, or I'm just beyond help.
And how long you been feeling like this, Andy?
So what you just did was you fell into the vomit.
Right away.
Yeah. Your initial reaction was to go back into time based upon the idea that my problem stems from some underlying circumstance that we can trace and find. And when we find that circumstance, basically, we'll do nothing other than wipe our ass and wait for the next meal. Everything you eat, Joe, comes out your ass in the end. And so all we're going to be doing is spending time eating and wiping our ass.
Okay.
That goes nowhere.
You're right.
It goes nowhere.
You're right. And I think we've kind of delved into traditional therapy. What are the flaws in with it?
Oh, yeah.
And I think we've covered quite a bit today. Do you have any last words, any last messages you want to give out to the listeners?
Yeah. I have a lot of people that come to see me and they don't do any of the work. They don't do any of the exercises. They don't read the book. They're more interested in complaining and moaning and groaning about how hard their life is. And so what I would say to the people that are listening is, hope is infectious. Hope is contagious. An attitude is contagious. Learn how to find that attitude for yourself. Learn how to find the hope that's inside of you. You're alive. Life is about potential and growth. That hope is inside of every human being. If you learn how to go inside and see life the way you truly desire it to be and stay with it, your biology will start to begin to feel those things. Over time, it'll change what you hear in your head. Try not to give up on yourself. There's always hope. There's a very, very complex world, but we can do this. We have to fight. We have to stop being so preoccupied with what we're feeling and start being more preoccupied with what we want to see in our lives, not just my life, but other people's lives as well.
And the world as a whole.
And the world as a whole. And remember, there are rules for everything. Even being crazy. Unfortunately, these are the rules we perfected to the point where the rules for being sane have become secret.
All right. Thank you, Andy. Remember to pick up the book, The 7 Secrets of Psychotherapy, available on Amazon now. Like, share, and subscribe this episode. Andy R. Schofield, Facebook, Instagram, YouTube, Twitter. You can find us all over social media. Please join the movement. Follow us. We'll talk to you soon. Thanks again.